matter how one feels about the space program, whether enthusiastic or convinced it has no relevance below the poverty line, it has changed our view of the world and understanding of ourselves. In less than a generation, man has severed the umbilical cord of gravity. He walked on the surface of another world. He looked back on his own world from space and awakened to the fact he inhabits a fragile and finite planet. He sent robot voyagers to the far reaches of the solar system. He breathed life into blueprints, computers, and machines, and changed old ideas forever. It all came together in July 1969. Man stood on the threshold of one of the most remarkable adventures in world history. He was about to enter the Moon Age. When it happened, it took only a dozen years. Yet for centuries, man's imagination had stretched far beyond his technology, never beyond his fancy. More than 100 years ago, Jules Verne wrote two remarkable accounts of lunar voyages, From the Earth to the Moon and its sequel, Around the Moon. Later, the three men recognized as the fathers of space flight were all to say they traced their early interest in aeronautics to these prophetic novels. There is an amazing parallel between them and Apollo's ventures into space a century later. Incredibly, Verne's fictional launch site was just 140 miles west of Cape Canaveral. Verne thought he could propel his spacecraft from the barrel of a mighty cannon. His moonship was shaped somewhat like Apollo and also built to carry three hardy adventurers. He called them aeronauts. Verne's basic calculation to escape Earth's gravity, 7 miles a second, was substantially correct, and he wrote of weightlessness. They saw they were no longer subject to the ordinary laws of nature. They looked like drunken men trying to maintain the perpendicular. Verne's description of the moon stands almost unchanged. He talked of desert beds, immense plains and cavities in the midst of circles. 1910. Verne's cosmic voyage caught the fascination and restless imagination of another Frenchman, George Méliès. The film remains a classic. Two decades later, the German director Fritz Lang's Girl in the Moon, for which rocket pioneer Hermann Oberth was technical advisor, a puree of science and melodrama. Oberth was one of three scientists closely linked to the early history of rocketry. But he was more a theoretician and an inspiration than an engineer. A second was an obscure Russian teacher of mathematics, Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, who wrote the first technical paper on the idea of an artificial Earth satellite. But in terms of experimentation, it was an American, Robert Goddard, whose combined theory and practice marked a major scientific turning point in history. As early as 1914, he secured two patents for a small engine, introducing the essential features of every modern rocket. Goddard made the world's first but unpublicized liquid fuel rocket demonstration in 1926 outside the town of Auburn, Massachusetts. 3 years later, he launched a larger rocket and a shock wave of publicity.
It was a quiet day and sound carried. And I think the residents of Auburn can be pardoned for mistaking it as an airplane coming down in flames, because a long jet streaming out had never been seen before. And by 4 o'clock that afternoon, there were extras on the street in great big letters. So the fire marshal stepped in and decided that it was not to the advantage of the state of Massachusetts to have these experiments done because of the danger of fire.
With encouragement from Colonel Charles Lindbergh, the quiet and persistent physics professor moved westward. Mrs. Goddard often returned to the New Mexico ranchland, where her husband pursued his experiments. Only segments of solitary boulders and pieces of rocket remain.
He was a loner in his work. Basic science is essentially a close dialogue between one man and nature. He is asking questions and listening for verdicts. Every time my husband set that rocket up, he was asking nature, is this it?
Stimulated by Goddard, the Germans had already launched a number of small rockets. A young engineer headed the vast military research center at Peenemünde on the Baltic Sea, Werner von Braun. There were initial frustrations. Late in World War II, the Nazis developed and fired thousands of V-2 rockets and buzz bombs at Allied targets. At war's end, von Braun and his know-how surrendered to the United States. Partially dismantled V-2s were sent stateside and reassembled at White Sands Proving Grounds in New Mexico, only 100 miles from where Goddard had spent his golden years. During a 5-year period, 66 rockets were tested. Many carried plants and animals. With each success, the fledgling American rocket program was on its way. In 1950, White Sands became too confining. Testing moved eastward to what a dozen years earlier had been a desolate triangle of sand dunes and swamps. In isolated patches, the terrain would begin to sprout gantries and other contours of the new science. There would be improbable successes and spectacular failures. Suddenly, there was Sputnik. Russia had put the world's first artificial satellite into orbit. It would decay after 3 months, but its impact would continue well beyond that brief lifetime. Soviet leaders boasted. Joyful crowds assembled in Moscow's Red Square. In the United States, there was more soul-searching than at any time since Pearl Harbor. President Dwight Eisenhower was initially unmoved by the post-Sputnik stampede.
Now, quite naturally, you will say, well, the Soviets gained a great psychological advantage throughout the world. And I think in the political sense, that's possibly true. But in the scientific sense, it is not true. Except for the proof of the one thing, that they have got the propellants and the projectors that will put these things in the air.
Just 2 months after Sputnik, this nation had high hopes for its initial effort to get back into the space race. Project Vanguard.
The huge red and white checkered gantry tower has now been pulled aside and brought back a distance of perhaps 200 yards to completely expose the three-stage rocket to view. Here she goes, flame is shooting out from under the bottom of it. And a huge, huge ball of fire rising up perhaps 100 feet. Apparently we've had some kind of difficulty on the pad. I do not see the missile rising into the air. The flame has gone out and black smoke is rising and curling off westward as the wind whips in from the sea. Certainly it was a failure. We don't know what the cause was, but the missile has been destroyed and fire hoses are now playing on the launching pad. 29 months of intensive labor, $100 million of expenditure has just gone up in a huge red-orange ball of smoke.
It had been Black Friday. Sputnik was a sharp blow to American pride. Vanguard, a knockdown. This was something new for the United States, playing catch-up. If the Russians could put a satellite in the sky, they could deliver a nuclear warhead wherever they wanted. It was a race the United States could not afford to lose.
The Army, meanwhile, was putting together its own satellite, called Explorer, a project which had been on Wernher von Braun's drawing board for years. Could in fact have been in orbit 6 months ahead of Sputnik if it had been given the authorization. The project finally got authorization after Sputnik 2 and was ready on the launch pad at Cape Canaveral just 80 days after that authorization. With the Vanguard fiasco fresh in everyone's memory, the Jupiter C rocket lifted off. The celebration was led by the three scientists, Pickering, von Braun, and Van Allen, who finally took the United States into the age of space.
To keep the military in check, the manned space program was put under civilian control with creation of the National Aeronautics and Space Agency. As flight became technologically possible, man in space remained somewhat of an enigma. Some scientists expressed doubts that the human system could withstand experiences so far outside conditions of life here on Earth. There had been little in the whole of evolution to prepare us for this. Beyond the sheltering atmosphere lay a hostile world, airless and laced with mysterious unknowns. In a 1956 film, Dr. Heinz Haber of the Air Force's Department of Space Medicine speculated on what man would find.
When the rocket engine finally stops, man will face his next big problem, weightlessness. Without support, he will be floating freely, drifting, tumbling, and twisting helplessly. In space, a man, a feather, a bubble, or a piece of iron will have the same weight, or rather, no weight at all. But weightlessness is not such an unearthly experience. We become weightless for a short while in a dive or in an elevator. But if we remove the support by cutting the cable, we produce the exact feeling of weightlessness in space. It will take iron nerves waiting for the impact that never comes. We can only hope that man in space will eventually get used to this feeling of falling constantly.
It was not man who got there first. Russia's Sputnik 2 carried the dog, Laika, into orbit. The United States turned to a 37-pound chimpanzee, nicknamed Ham, as its first cosmic traveler. He spent 15 minutes in space. Then came cousin Enos.
In the making. Scientists are elated at the condition of both chimp and capsule. They came through the test in a manner that brings a manned flight closer to reality for the U.S. space team.
The first group of American astronaut candidates began training in 1959, subjected to virtually every extreme of physical and psychological stress. Among them, acceleration up to 15 G's. the astronauts seemed less concerned than the scientists. Out of 36 finalists, 7 were chosen to be the first American voyagers into space, Project Mercury. All were under 40 years of age, less than 5 feet 11 inches in height, in excellent physical condition, had a college degree or equivalent, were graduates of a test pilot school, had at least 1,500 hours of jet flight time. But only one could be first. Navy Lieutenant Commander Alan Shepard.
Certainly all of us wanted very much to make the flight, and I'm sure that had anyone else had the opportunity, he would have been equally proud as I was on that day, having been selected to go first. There was a wide difference of opinion as to how a man would react under weightless conditions for a period as long as 5 minutes and at a time. This was pretty traumatic concern among some members of the medical community. And Glenn and Grissom and myself actually went to Navy facility in Johnsville, Pennsylvania, where a centrifuge was prepared for our special use to run some more tests to, in fact, indicate that we could respond very well to weightlessness for periods as long as 5 minutes at a time.
Ironically, it was not Shepard, but a Russian who removed any lingering medical qualms about weightlessness. April 1961. Again, Moscow had grabbed the spotlight. Cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin became the first human being to orbit the Earth. As with Sputnik, American space efforts seemed sluggish.
This May Day celebration in Moscow gives the Russians the opportunity to crow loud and long over the West. For the theme running through the parade is Triumph in Space. They have no intention of letting the world forget that they were first in orbit. And of course, Yuri Gagarin is the featured guest who sees a rocket balloon launched in his honor.
Shepard, meantime, intensified training for his pioneer mission.
I heard the news at Cape Canaveral while I was training for my flight, America's first manned effort. May 5th, 1961 had dawned hot and clear. The Redstone rocket, of course, was small by today's standards. At the launch pad, one burning question kept crossing my mind. Would I be good enough? I had already discounted failure with the machine. I could cope with that. But would I panic? Would I make a mistake?
Oh, Roger, lift off and the clock has started. Yes, sir, reading you loud and clear. This is Freedom 7. The fuel is go, 1.2G, cabin at 14 p.m.
There was no discomfort during launch or reentry. A beautiful flight. It was all over in 15 minutes, reaching an altitude of 116 miles, landing and recovery 300 miles downrange in the Atlantic. The greatest satisfaction would come 3 weeks later when President Kennedy, elated over this success, made his commitment to reach for the moon.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
This is Friendship 7, first generation of American spacecraft in Project Mercury. Room enough for one man, medium height, to be strapped inside. The skeptics called it Man in a Can on an ICBM. Friendship 7 carried 7 miles of wire, almost 200 instruments, and in February 1962, a 40-year-old astronaut named John Glenn into 3 orbits of the Earth. Unhappily, the Russians were already 2 steps ahead.
Herman Titov of Russia returns to Earth after orbiting the globe 17 times in a little more than 25 hours, covering 435,000 miles, which is more than twice the distance from the Earth to the Moon. An orbit by a U.S. astronaut is planned later this year. Radio Moscow reports that the 26-year-old Titov landed exactly in the planned area. This view is of the Earth.
To add insult to injury, his craft passed over the United States 3 times. Titov remains the youngest person ever to go into space. It was 6 months before NASA decided to burn its bridges. February 20th, 1962. John Glenn would sit there during a series of holds, dragging through more than 2 hours. But then, he'd waited almost 3 long years for this moment.
You are go. Water systems,
go.
Range operations,
clear to launch.
Mercury capsule, go.
May the wee ones be with you, Thomas.
Good Lord, ride all the way.
Godspeed, John Glenn.
Roger, 0G, and I feel fine. Capsule is turning around. Oh, that view is tremendous. Roger, understand, go for at least seven...
The first
orbit.
American to orbit the globe.
And this is the capsule itself being lifted from the water by a crane aboard the destroyer. There he is now in his spacesuit. He is out of the capsule, as you can see. This was the very beginning of the immediate medical debriefing. And a few moments later, another picture was made of Colonel Glenn on the telephone, and it is our understanding that this picture was made while Colonel Glenn was in voice communication with President Kennedy, who had called from the White House in Washington. This afternoon, President Kennedy strode from his White House office to put into words the feelings of millions of Americans about a 40-year-old test pilot.
We have a long way to go in the space race. We started late, but this is the new ocean. And I believe the United States must sail on it and be in a position second to none. Some years, months ago, I said that I hoped that every American would serve his country. Today, Colonel Glenn served his, and we all express our thanks to him.
There was reaction everywhere, a mixture of relief, pride, and exaltation. Honors and celebrations. A quarter of a million persons lined the rainy streets of Washington to pour out their admiration. Then, on to New York to travel the glory road of other heroes. The first American to ever see the coastlines of continents from outer space said he'd never seen anything like this.
We are all proud to have been privileged to be part of this effort, to represent our country as we have. As our knowledge of this universe in which we live increases, may God grant us the wisdom and guidance to use it wisely.
With the Glenn flight a success, American industry more firmly hitched its wagon to the infinite, and the money flowed. Project Gemini, the two-man spacecraft. There were 10 manned missions stretching over 20 months. A new shot was put up every 6 to 8 weeks. The ability to rendezvous and dock two space vehicles in orbit would be fundamental to the success of a moon landing. Gemini 8 made the first successful docking with an unmanned orbiting target vehicle. Its commander, Neil Armstrong.
Man, that's great.
Man, that is really slick.
You're looking good on the ground. Go ahead and dock. Roger. Flight, we are down.
Early 1965, a 30-year-old Soviet cosmonaut, Alexei Leonov, became the first man to move outside an orbiting spacecraft. Once again, the Russians had stolen the limelight. With almost knee-jerk reaction, NASA responded to the challenge.
Okay, I'm out.
Okay, you're
2 months after Leonov, Air Force Colonel Ed White was the first American to walk in space. Using a kind of handheld gun for propulsion part of the time, he spent 21 minutes outside and walked 6,000 miles, twice as long and far as Leonov.
I feel like $1 million. This is the greatest experience I've, it's just tremendous.
White said he was having so much fun, he didn't want to go back inside. Pilot James McDivitt had to use harsh words to get him back.
The flight director says get back in.
Okay, they want you to come back in now.
Back in?
Back in.
Just before the spacecraft entered total darkness. Four others also floated outside their Gemini craft or poked their bodies through an open hatch. Some things about space can only be learned in space. Astronauts built on experience, the skills of maneuvering, a tested worldwide recovery force and tracking network, making precise landings from orbit, proving man could live and work in space in weightlessness for as long as 2 weeks, a period far longer than necessary for Apollo's round trip to the moon. Until July 1964, our knowledge of the moon changed very little. Both the United States and Russia had launched unmanned lunar probes in the late 1950s. Russia again led the way. Luna 2 hit the moon in 1959, and Luna 3 orbited it, sending back the first crude pictures of the far side. The United States did not score a success until the eighth try, 5 years later. 17,000 pictures were relayed back to Earth by three Ranger spacecraft, which hard landed on the surface. These were the first close-ups. The next epochal stage in lunar photography began with soft landings on the surface. Another Russian first, Luna 9, in early 1966. The United States caught up 18 months later in a sensational way. Surveyors scanned, pounded, and scraped the surface, ending fears the moon might be unable to support the weight of a manned spacecraft. America entered the climactic venture with justifiable confidence. Pad 34, late in January 1967. Optimism was high as the crew of the first Apollo mission, Ed White, Gus Grissom, and Roger Chaffee, took part in a full-scale simulation, just 3 weeks away from scheduled launch. Knowledge of risk is basic to any pioneering venture. Yet, not one man had ever been lost or even hurt. It was taking too much for granted. When it came suddenly, and where least expected, on the ground.
We interrupt our normal programming in order to bring you this special report from NBC News.
Good evening. Astronauts Virgil Grissom, Edward White, and Roger Chaffee have been killed in a flash fire during a rehearsal of the countdown and launch of the Apollo flight they were to have made on the 21st of next month.
The way back was not easy. Emotions were on edge. There were constant reminders that the program had paid dearly for one period of overconfidence. But in a grim way, the tragedy would contribute to later successes. It was nearly 2 years before confidence was really restored by the flight of Apollo 7. The ghost of what NASA simply called the fire was exorcised by 11 days in Earth orbit in the first of the last bold steps to the moon.
We have you go for orbit here, go for orbit.
Beautiful. Now, the string of successes came regularly. Apollo 8 made a Christmas trip to the moon, the first manned spacecraft to orbit the lunar surface. The crew was overwhelmed.
No, frame to the vast loneliness up here on the moon is awe-inspiring. It makes you realize just what you have back there on Earth. The Earth from here is a grand oasis of the big vastness of space.
God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear, and it was so. And God called the dry land Earth, and the gathering together of the waters called these seas. And God saw that it was good. And from the crew of Apollo 8, we close with good night, good luck, a Merry Christmas, and God bless all of you on the good Earth.
Apollo 9. The spidery, flimsy flying machine, which would carry astronauts to and from the moon, was tested in Earth orbit.
But you're upside down again. Hey, I was just thinking one of us isn't right side up.
The Lunar Module, LEM for short.
Okay, Dave, come on out.
The first in-flight test, too, of the extravehicular backpack, which would support an astronaut's life on the lunar surface. The mission was a resounding success. Yet, ironically, was the most anonymous of all the Apollo flights.
Hello, Houston, Houston, this is Snoopy.
Right, Snoop, go ahead.
We is going, we is down among them, Charlie. I tell you, we're down here where we can touch the top of some hills, though.
Apollo 10 surveyed and photographed the primary target area for 11, a landing site in the east near the lunar equator, the Sea of Tranquility. Flat, stable, with only small craters in the vicinity, it harbored no insurmountable hazards to a manned landing.
Boy, this view has got to be a fantastic thing.
With Apollo 10 in lunar orbit, 11 was already in position on pad 39. It would be the summer of 1969. The Vietnam War would continue taking its toll among the strains and tensions of 20th century life, of a nation fast losing its innocence, of a significant minority still living in poverty. For some, the American dream would be undiminished.
You missed, he's gonna stick it right in your gizzard.
For others, whatever happened to it. For most, it would be an average July day, unfolding like any summer afternoon. Yet nothing in a nation's lifetime would promise to outlast the wonder of man's greatest adventure. For everyone involved, it was a Walter Mitty world. Even the worker who tightened the smallest connection had a keen sense of participation.
I'm just as excited as I can be. I've pointed out to my people that we're standing on the threshold of a discovery that man has not seen for over 400 years, and I'm just tickled pink.
This is the one. This is the one that's going to tell us whether we have got it or haven't got it.
There's no telling what we're on the threshold of right now. It's probably like it was back in the days of Columbus. Nobody knew what was going to happen when Columbus set sail.
It's real impressive. It's one of the biggest things in my life.
It's something you don't ever get used to. The more you see, the more you want to see.
I'm very much surprised that we really are here. But in the evening when I look out to the moon, it has come a little closer. It is not quite the distance anymore.
The astronauts were ready. The luck of the draw had made Apollo 11 their mission. All were 39 years old, and flying was a religion to them. Air Force Lieutenant Colonel Michael Collins, West Point graduate, son of an Army general. Air Force Colonel Edward Buzz Aldrin from Montclair, New Jersey. Infant sister couldn't pronounce brother, it came out Buzz. Graduate engineer, fighter pilot in Korean War. And Neil Armstrong, the spacecraft commander from Wapakoneta, Ohio. Learned to fly before he was old enough to get a driver's license. Flew combat in Korea, now a civilian. In the mold of a classic American hero, taciturn, tough.
We're on time at the present time for our planned liftoff of 32 minutes past the hour.
Honeysuckle, this is Goddard Network. Would you give us the status, please, of your antenna slew check?
We see no problems for the Apollo 11 launch.
Roger, Honeysuckle, thank you. Madrid.
All checks at Madrid have been completed. We are go for launch.
Billions of dollars, millions of man-hours of research, thousands of persons mobilized, all the complex systems and devices flight-tested. Normally, when history is made, we don't know it until it is history. But on a July morning in 1969, we knew. It was precisely 9:32 a.m. Eastern Time.
Good luck and Godspeed. Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
Three Americans, a special breed of 20th century explorers, were on their way. That summer afternoon, three men were traveling through the blackness of space to the moon. Not just three astronauts, but something of mankind.
Houston, Apollo 11 Insider gave us a magnificent ride.
Apollo 11, this is Houston.
You guys are dominating all the news back here in Earth. Even Pravda in Russia is headlining the mission and calls Neil the czar of the ship.
In the sports world, the Houston Astros rallied in the ninth inning at Cincinnati to dump the Reds 7-4.
Your three wives and children got together for lunch yesterday at Buzz's house.
Astronauts are not the only explorers in the news. San Diego awaits the arrival of Mrs. Sharon Adams on her solo crossing of the Pacific. The California couple said they plan to marry at the precise moment Armstrong sets foot on the loop.
GIs north of Saigon were evacuating village.
Mario Andretti now takes the lead in U.S. auto.
A new line of space toys drew impressive crowds of children.
Chicago
young Jordanian beat over Viet Cong's American League missile debate.
We see a real display now.
That same guy that when you open up the doorway.
For the astronauts, the 71 and one-half hour journey to the moon was almost routine. With the command module called Columbia and the lunar module christened Eagle, they circled the moon for a day.
Roger.
Unlocking from Columbia, Eagle stayed close by for more than 20 minutes. When Eagle reached 50,000 feet, Armstrong and Aldrin would blast their rocket to slow themselves down. For 12 minutes, the engine would roar continuously as Eagle fell along a steadily sharpening path to the moon.
Flying like a flying machine there, Eagle, despite the fact you're upside down.
Somebody's upside down.
Altitude 4200.
Houston, you're a go for landing, over.
With Eagle on autopilot, Armstrong saw the projected target site was littered with boulders as big as automobiles. He seized manual control, flying to a point just beyond. Eagle landed with only 20 seconds of fuel left.
Down 2.5. Forward. Forward. 30 feet down, 2.5. Picking up some dust. 30 feet, 2.5 down. Fake shadow. 4 forward. 4 forward, drifting to the right a little. 20, down a half.
30 seconds.
Forward, just. Ready? Contact light. Okay, engine stop. Houston, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
The moment of triumph was the landing. After touchdown, Buzz and I shook hands without saying a word, but knew that we'd made it.
It's a museum piece now, this spidery, flimsy-looking flying machine, the likes of which ferried American astronauts to and from the moon. The Lunar Module, LEM for short. Its outside skin, no thicker than several dozen layers of plastic kitchen wrap. Things jutting out at all angles, but then streamlining isn't critical in the airless atmosphere of the moon. Or weight, gravity being only 1/6 of what it is here on the floor of the National Air and Space Museum. With this ungainly moonship, man first landed on another celestial body. Once ready, Armstrong opened the hatch and slowly, gingerly moved down the ladder. Aldrin remained inside. Just a few feet below was the lunar soil.
This is Houston, radio check and verify TV circuit breaker in.
But first, Armstrong would pause on the disc-like footpad at the end of the ladder. Momentarily, centuries of speculation about the lunar surface and man's ability to survive there would be over. It was 10:56 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time.
I'm going to step off the limb now. That's one small step for man. One giant leap for mankind.
That's one small step for man.
Un pequeño paso para
one giant leap for mankind.
Para
Adragut, l'Anderson, Anderson, Yarnitiano.
C'est un bond en avant gigantesque.
Magnifique. Hell is on the moon.
À 22h50.
On a changé tout. On peut dire que je des chefs du voyage.
I almost don't even believe it. But it's true. And if this is not a permanent, enduring event in human history, then nothing is. And it certainly will be remembered as long as mankind remembers anything.
Surface is fine and battery, but I can see the footprints of my boots and the treads. Okay, it's quite dark here in the shadow and a little hard for me to see that I have good footing. I'll work my way over into the sunlight here without looking directly into the sun.
Aldrin, the second man on the moon, followed Armstrong in 20 minutes.
Beautiful view. Isn't that something?
The astronauts uncovered a plaque on the landing gear.
July 1969 AD. It came in peace for all mankind. It has the crew members' signatures and the signature of the President of the United States.
They did what they came to do.
The flag now in the lunar soil, being held out in an unfurled position by a spring device.
It's a little wire that runs right up the top of it, Russ. Keeps it sticking out in the airless world.
Overhead, Mike Collins could hear but not watch the unfolding drama.
Columbia, this is Houston reading you loud and clear. Right, the EVA is progressing beautifully.
Great.
I guess you're about the only person around that doesn't have TV coverage of the scene.
That's all right, I don't mind a bit.
Neil and Buzz, the President of the United States.
This was still John Kennedy's Apollo, but he was gone. Richard Nixon was president. He would make that first historic phone call.
Go ahead, Mr. President. This is Houston out.
Hello, Neil and Buzz.
I'm talking to you by telephone from the Oval Room at the White House.
For one priceless moment in the whole history of man, all the people on this earth are truly one. One in their pride in what you have done, and one in our prayers that you will return safely to Earth.
Thank you, Mr. President.
In the 21st hour on the moon came the last real moment of high tension. If the rocket engine failed on liftoff, they would be condemned to death a quarter of a million miles away from home.
Guidance recommendation is pings, and you're cleared for takeoff.
Roger, understand. We're number one on the runway. 7, 6, 5, port stage, engine arm ascent.
Eagle rocketed away from Tranquility Base, firing on time, boosting the moonship into the long elliptical path toward Columbia, cruising overhead. Worldwide, there were sighs of relief and prayers of thanks. Soviet news coverage was the widest ever given an American space mission. The chase, in which Eagle would catch up with Columbia, would take more than 3 hours.
AAG degrees within a foot per second.
The chase ended more than 60 nautical miles above the front of the moon, in an orbit where Collins had remained in lonely vigil. Not since Adam, perhaps, had one man known such solitude. Eagle and Columbia would rejoin. After half a day, Apollo 11 broke out of lunar gravity, headed for home. Fifty-seven hours later, it would thread the needle of entry into Earth environment and splash down in the Pacific Ocean.
And the flight of Apollo 11 is over. The men are on the ocean.
We've had word from Mike Collins inside the spacecraft. He says the crew is excellent. The crew is excellent.
The spacecraft flipped upside down after splashdown, but swim teams soon had it right. The hatch was open. The astronauts came out slowly. They were lifted into a helicopter for a ride to the carrier 13 miles away. On the Hornet, President, other dignitaries from Washington. They came out of the chopper looking like men from another planet. At that time, there was some concern, which turned out later to be unfounded, that the astronauts might have brought back some exotic germs from the moon. They and their cargo were in quarantine for 3 weeks.
Buzz and Mike, I want you to know that I think I'm the luckiest man in the world. And I say this not only because I have the honor to be President of the United States, but particularly because I have the privilege of speaking for so many and welcoming you back to Earth.
The triumph lasted into autumn. The astronauts were living proof that a world tour could take more out of a man than a journey to the moon and back. With cheers still echoing for Apollo 11, 12 was already sitting on the launch pad. Late 1969, after a hairy but successful launch in a thunderstorm, Apollo 12, appropriately enough, headed for the ocean of storms on the moon, aiming for a spot within walking distance of an unmanned surveyor that had landed 2 years earlier. A near bullseye after 240,000 miles, only 600 feet from the derelict surveyor. Two successful missions so close together in 1969 made it seem routine.
You know what I feel like now? You ever see those pictures of giraffes running in slow motion? Exactly what I feel like.
But this feeling came to an abrupt end during the flight of Apollo 13. Launched at the 13th minute of the 13th hour, number 13 very nearly was lost in space on the 13th day of the month, when an oxygen tank exploded in the ship's service module.
The whole panel is blown out, almost from the base to the engine.
Really a mess. Man, that's unbelievable.
A horrified world waited and prayed as the crew and ground support figured out a way to get back from the moon. They did, and the world remembered the crew's words from an earlier flight. God bless the good Earth. Apollo 13's near disaster brought changes in hardware. It was almost 10 months before astronauts were flying again. Lunar exploration began in earnest.
Oh, this is really a wild place up here.
What a fantastic sight.
Oh, this is really profound.
Look at the size of that rock.
I was strolling on the moon one day.
10. 3 feet per second. Contact down.
New stop. Auto, auto.
We're on the surface.
Okay, we made a good landing.
Apollo 14 set down on a gentle, dusty slope between two small craters. Astronauts Alan Shepard and Ed Mitchell walked across the bewildering terrain. After more than 9 hours on the lunar surface, the normally staid Shepard pulled the surprise of the mission. He became the moon's first golfer.
There we go.
That looked like a slice to me, Al.
Miles and miles and miles.
Falcon is on the plane at Hadley.
Astronauts Dave Scott and Jim Irwin spent almost 19 hours outside. Moon watchers focused on a machine that all the world wanted to see, a lightweight electric car, the Lunar Rover. All in all, they traveled 17 miles, took more than 1,100 pictures, and collected 100 documented soil and rock samples, including the geological prize of the voyage.
Guess what we just found? I think we found what we came for. Crystal rock, huh? Yes, sir.
The Genesis rock, more than 4 billion years old, older than any rock on Earth. 6%, the voyage of Apollo 16 took it to the Descartes Mountains, the moon's oldest and most rugged terrain.
Come on out here and give me a salute.
John Young and Charlie Duke were the most enthusiastic landing party since Apollo 12. Duke even tried one big jump for man. Young and Duke were excited by the bits and pieces of the moon that lay at their feet. Fittingly enough, the last Apollo launch was the most spectacular, the first ever at night. A trail of fire and vapor visible as far away as Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. 17 would be the longest Apollo mission of all.
Stand by for pitch over. Oh, are we coming in?
12 days, 13 hours.
And there it is, Houston, there's Camelot. Wide on target, I see it.
The landing was hard by a crater at Taurus Littrow in rugged mountain country.
53 degrees. Okay, I've got Moray, I've got Poppy, I've got the triangle.
That's Commander Gene Cernan and professional geologist Harrison Jack Schmidt found it rougher than anticipated.
8,000, 8,000 is good. There is orange soil.
The most unexpected and important geological find.
It's all over. Orange. Don't move it till I see it. I've stirred it up with my feet. Hey, it is. I can see it from here. It's orange. We'd like to share a piece of this rock with so many of the countries throughout the world. We hope that this will be a symbol of what our feelings are, what the feelings of the Apollo program are, and a symbol of mankind that we can live in peace and harmony in the future. History will record that America's challenge of today has forged man's history of tomorrow.
Words from the surface of the moon, for the last time from Commander Cernan.
Houston, run away, Houston. That's your good. Excellent.
Sunday afternoon, December 20th, 1972. 17 splashed down. The age of manned lunar exploration had lasted exactly 4 years. That it had been done at all was amazing. That it had been done in such a short span of time was breathtaking. There would be 4 more Apollo flights. 3 took crews up to America's embryonic space station, Skylab, orbited in 1973. The Apollo era ended on an ironic note, orbital detente. An American Apollo, a Russian Soyuz, rivals superpowers who had spent the first 2 decades of the space age in intense competition. July 17th, 1975. The moment was here. An American astronaut from Weatherford, Oklahoma, shook hands with a Soviet cosmonaut from the village of Listvoyovka.
Hi, Bill. Glad to see you. Call your family.
They spent 44 hours linked together. No American astronaut would venture into space for another 7 years. The golden era of Apollo had ended. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner still wave? 12 Americans had walked, some even gambled, across the powdery surface. With no wind or erosion, mute evidence of their visit will be visible for 500,000 years. There were 6 moon craft left behind, 3 moon buggies, scientific instruments, and footprints in magnificent desolation. The legacy of Apollo would next ride on the wings of the space shuttle. Now that man had taken those first steps, there would be no turning back. For man, H.G. Wells once wrote, there is no rest and no ending.
I was strolling on the moon one day in a merry, merry month of December.
Now, May is the month.
May, that's right.
May is the year of the month.
When there, much to my surprise, a pair of moony eyes.
Wow, what a place. What a view, isn't it, John?
It's absolutely unreal.
Look at the size of that rock.
Tell me, how about an extension, you guys? We're feeling good.
Dad always comes to tonight when we're around to talk.